Good morning, class. Nice to see you all. Maybe I'll just pull this a little bit too. So it's cliffhanger day today. I'll say more about things working. I guess so, no one's complaining. I'll say more about Alencon's approach to the index theorem. What I'm going to, you'll see as we go through today's material, that there are a couple of issues which are left up for grabs. There's going to be one or two analytical issues, is such and such a continuous field and so on, that I'm not going to spend time on. These things are dealt with in a similar way to the way things that we've dealt with already. And then there are things in K-theory. We have officially only a modest acquaintance with K-theory in this class. And in order to seal the deal in the index theorem and write down an actual formula, you need to know more about K-theory. You need to be able to calculate certain isomorphisms, which we don't have the technology to do so in this class today. So that's what's going to happen. I'll indicate the lay of the land, the way the argument goes, but there'll be one or two places where we'll just leave some details for your imagination. However, it's possible to strip down the argument that I'm about to give when you deal with certain specific operators, Dirac operators. And so in the next lecture, oh, yes, we need the... Oh.
It's a fisheye now.
Oh. Wow. What's it doing? It's crazy. It's like, it's what exactly what the people in Hollywood are striking about. It's talented professionals being replaced by AI. That's exactly what's happening, and we are witnessing it in this class.
That's great.
Our brilliant cinematographer has been made superfluous. Just a few lines of code, and that's it. Terrible. Anyway, on Thursday, I'll show you a stripped down argument. I mean, it's still a complete argument, but it makes some of the things which are going to be left mysterious today a little more explicit. That's the good news. Everything is more concrete, will be more concrete on Thursday than it is today. The bad news is that we'll be looking specifically at the Dirac operator. But I mean, who cares about anything except the Dirac operator? All right. So here is the main construction, which we already talked about a little bit on all those days ago. On the last Thursday, we had a class. Suppose you have a Lie groupoid. And a manifold, smooth manifold. On which G acts. And what does that mean? Well, let's suppose we're also given a morphism, smooth map, well, a map, let's just say to begin with, from G into the group of diffeomorphisms of E, which is a functor. This is a group, and so it's a category with one object. And G is a groupoid, so it's a category with potentially many objects, but you can talk about a functor from one category to the other. What it does on objects is predetermined, because this only has one object, so every object goes to the unique object in this group, groupoid, which is just the identity element of the group. And it should be functorial, so the key condition is that alpha of any composition should be the composition of the alphas. Whenever this makes sense, it should be true. And we'd like this action map this is a big infinite dimensional space, so we don't want to discuss what it is as a manifold. But what's relevant here is that this action map should be smooth. Obviously, gamma, comma, E goes to alpha of gamma applied to E. This should be smooth. All right. So this is what we're going to play around with. And it's worth saying that more general arrangements are possible. More general possibilities exist. Because when a groupoid acts on a space, I mean, a groupoid is like a family of groups. And so an action of a groupoid on a space should really be an action of a groupoid on a family of spaces, or a family of actions of groups on a space somehow. It's possible to build more fancy actions. And roughly speaking, if you're thinking of a groupoid as some sort of family of groups, then we're studying here actions of groupoids on some sort of family of spaces in which we're dealing with constant families of spaces. They're all just E. But you could make a more general thing, construction here if you wanted to. Good reasons for doing it, but not exactly. Those more general constructions aren't exactly going to be relevant today. Anyway, here's the thing that we briefly discussed last time. It's just a construction we already saw in the simplified situation where big G was a group. It's just triples. So in E times G times E, I'll keep writing that down, such that E2, you can get to E2 by applying alpha to gamma and then applying that to E1. And this thing is, this new thing is a groupoid too, because you can define the source of a triple to be, well, you just apply the source map to gamma and then E1. So that'll put you in whatever the objects are for G. We've usually been calling that W times E. And same thing for the range. Oopsie. It's sort of annoying that you have to put the range of gamma on the other side of E2, but nothing to be done about that. Yeah. So W here is the objects. Of G. And there's an obvious composition law, which we discussed last time. Which is a formula that we've seen in some variations again and again and again. Like that. And so this new thing is a new Lie groupoid. The cross product or transformation groupoid associated with this action above. This thing. And just a little remark. Which I'll make just once. The source fibers of this thing are the same as source fibers of G itself, in by projection onto the G factor in these triples. Right? If you want to look at all triples which begin with E1, which start at some E1, comma WW, comma E1. Well, that determines what E1 is. And once you know what E1 is, and you know what gamma is, you know what E2 is. So the projection from a source fiber along the middle projection down to G itself will be a diffeomorphism from the source fiber inside of G acting on E to a source fiber inside of G. They're all the same source fibers. They have the same, I mean, they're diffeomorphic as manifolds. So when we come to building, remember all of the nightmarish discussions we had about densities and so on, and the French. When we come to building convolution algebras using densities, or not, as the case may be, well, we've already done it once. If we've already done it for G, we don't have to do it again for G times E. That's the point. Okay. All right. Good. So what do we want to do with this? Well, we want to look at some examples. Of course, somehow we want to make an example which has to do with the tangent groupoid of a manifold M, but one thing at a time. Let's just go kind of slowly to get a sense of what this is going to do for us and why Alain was interested in this construction. Let's consider just a few easy cases to begin with. If G is a group, so G itself is a category of one object, not just this, you know, this other group, diffeo E that we have over here. If G is a group, then this is a construction we've already seen, because the very first time I uttered the word groupoid in this room, we considered exactly this construction in the special case where big G was just a little g, just a regular group, okay? And now we're just want to focus in a little bit on some simple cases acting freely and properly, or principally, as they say, on E. In this case, so this is an object we already defined, and you can write this fellow as the following. You can just look at pairs G, E. Maybe I should call it G1, E1, G2, E2. Am I doing this the right way? Let me just check my notation, make sure I want to. Yeah, so I don't even need the G here. Need the E's. So let me try to speak in a complete sentence. If G is acting freely on E, and if we consider a triple E2, comma little g, comma little E1, then E2 and E1 alone are enough to tell you what G is. The projection map from E2, comma G, comma E1, just to E2, E1, that's going to be one-to-one. I mean, you won't necessarily hit all pairs E2, E1, because this action may not be transitive. There may be no way of getting from E1 to E2 by applying a group element G. But if there is a way, it's unique. There's only one G which just does the job. So we could drop, as we did earlier on when we were studying the tangent group, or we could drop the fellow G from the notation. And if we did that, we would end up with the following description of this semi-direct product. Like this. So what we're doing here is we're projecting onto the first and third factors in this threefold product situation. What's pi? Well, it's just the obvious quotient map from E to the space you get by dividing E by G, the set of all orbits. Because the action is free and proper, this thing here is a smooth manifold. What's a proper action? Well, let's just say it's an action with the property that G mod E, this fellow here, is a smooth manifold. What do I mean by that? I mean that if you define a sheaf of functions on this space to be all of the functions you get by looking at smooth functions on E, which are constant on orbits, then that is the smooth sheaf of smooth functions for a smooth structure on G mod E. Because the action is assumed to be nice, this thing in a natural way is a smooth manifold. The function on this guy is smooth if and only if its composition with this projection map is a smooth function back on E. Great. And what we're looking at here is just this construction, which doesn't depend anymore on the group. It just depends on this item from geometry, if you like, this smooth map between two smooth manifolds, this submersion from one smooth manifold to another. So the group has gone. And what's left is just some geometry, the geometry of this map. Over this manifold G mod E, don't know how to say it, mod G E, I don't know. Anyway, this over the orbit space, there is a sort of in quotation marks bundle whose fibers are the G orbits. And that's the geometry I'm talking about. So this map here is not just a diffeomorphism. The above is an isomorphism, the diffeomorphism and an equivalence of groupoids. So it's an isomorphism of Lie groupoids. In this situation, when the action is free and proper, the groupoid G cross E, it doesn't actually depend on G, it just depends on the orbits of G. As we saw when we were first defining the tangent groupoid, we defined it using actions which were indeed free and proper, in fact, free and proper and transitive. And we already made this observation. Great. On the other hand, we had a little discussion about K-theory last time. And one of the things we observed is that if you look at groupoids which come from submersions, like this one does, then there's a simple formula for what the K theory is. There's a canonical isomorphism like this. Well, first of all, here's our groupoid. And thanks to the isomorphism I've written above, that's the same thing. Not sure how I'll write it, how I did write it, but I'll write it like this. Now, that's the same thing as the groupoid or the K theory of the sister algebra of the groupoid written on the right-hand side above. Just pairs E2, E1, which project to the same point. And this is what we observed last time. This is just the K theory of the sister algebra of functions on the space, which is G mod E. So when we were listing the desirable, useful properties of K-theory, this was one of them. If you build a non-commutative sister algebra this way, it's not actually that complicated at all. I mean, full stop, it's not complicated at all. But in particular, its K-theory is not complicated at all. It's just the K-theory of some space. And I say just there because our running assumption is that we have access to experts in algebraic topology who can calculate for us and understand for us the K-theory of any reasonable topological space. Okay. Those experts, I guess I'm supposed to be one, but they're basically, we're not supposing that we are those experts. We're imagining that we have access to such an expert. Okay, so in this particular case, the cross product construction has the desirable desirable effect, you might say, which is that after you make this construction, the groupoid and its K-theory become easy. Okay. Let's look at another example. Oh, let's fancify this example up a little bit. Suppose we have a vector bundle over a smooth manifold, M. Of course, I'm thinking about the tangent bundle, which we saw, you know, playing a very significant role in the tangent groupoid. But right now, any vector bundle will do. Okay. And suppose we have a map like this. An embedding into a constant bundle, trivial bundle. That's the same thing for this fellow here. It's just some fixed real vector space. Finite dimension. That's real, not real. That's the same thing as just specifying a map alpha. If this is an embedding of vector bundles, then what happens, the formula for what happens in this component here is prescribed, because the any map of vector bundles must be a map over the base space M. So all you're really doing is you're prescribing a map alpha like this, with the property that alpha of v1 plus v2 is equal to alpha of v1 plus alpha of v2, if v1 and v2 lie in the same fiber of the vector bundle v. Which is to say, all you're doing is you're giving an instance of this construction over here. Like that. So if we think of V as a Lie groupoid, then we can apply this construction. Our new today construction. Say again. Yes. I think that maybe if I add a little more detail here, your question will be answered. So think of here E as included in the collection, the group of all diffeomorphisms of E, as the translations. So we're, the alpha which has been given here doesn't look like a map alpha into the diffeomorphisms of E until you remember that each element of E gives a diffeomorphism of E by translation. Thank you. And what is this thing that we've built? Well, let Q be the quotient vector bundle that you get by dividing the vector bundle by V. I write V, maybe I should write alpha of V, the image of V under this embedding. So this is a quotient, a vector bundle. And let's give a name for this. Let Q be, sorry, pi be the quotient map. And now let's think about what this construction over here of the transformation groupoid does. So what are we dealing with here? We're dealing with triples consisting of two vectors in E and a vector in some, you know, arbitrary fiber of the vector bundle V. And the condition is this condition here. Of course, we should now write this additively. E2 is alpha of V plus E1. Okay, so the condition, and once again, alpha is assumed to be an embedding. So if there is a V1 such that E2 minus E1 is alpha of V1, I should have just called it V. If there is a little v such that E2 minus E1 is alpha of V, then that V is unique, at least in any given fiber of the vector bundle. So I can write this transformation groupoid made out of triples in a more economical way, because E2, E1 basically determine gamma. Not exactly, because you also have to remember which fiber you're in, but the following will do it. We call it V, thought of as a groupoid acting on E, is just the set of pairs like this. Such that pi of m e 2 is equal to pi of m e 1. And the map is, well, you know what e 2, and so we want to map from the right hand side to the left hand side, and clearly, so we have to specify for each of these fellows over here a triple, and E2, comma, gamma, comma, E1 triple. And what's it going to be? Well, it's going to be E2 in the first slot, and then E2 minus E1 in the second slot, and then E1 in the third slot. And E2 minus E1 is required, thanks to this condition, to be in the fiber of the vector bundle V over the point M. And so you can write it in gamma form, so to speak, as on the left-hand board. Okay, so we're again in a very easy situation. This is again an isomorphism of Lie groupoids. And so by this discussion, what we have is that the K theory of the C star algebra of V, acting on E, is equal to the K theory of the space, the C zero functions on the space Q. Spaces, geometry. No operators or non-commutative. Nothing. It's just spaces that we're dealing with. All right, one more example somewhere. Maybe we'll here. So let's start now with a smooth manifold, which I guess we sort of had before. And let's do the following thing. Let's just consider any map from M into the group of diffeomorphisms of E. So this is any map with some modest smoothness property, for example, this one. The action map that we were discussing before, let's assume that it's smooth. Did I give it an M? Yes, H.
Like example four, but just get that as the obvious.
Yeah, I'm going to jazz this up in the next line, and maybe that will help. So now let G be a groupoid that we've seen, the so-called pair groupoid, the set of all M2 comma M1s, with the obvious, the objects are just M, and the source and range map are the two projections, and composition is given by the usual formula, this formula here, except the E's should be M's and there shouldn't be any gammas. Okay. Then you can build an alpha just by taking H of M to inverse H of M1. So that attaches to each morphism in this category a diffeomorphism. And the composition property is satisfied, evidently, just by staring at it. All right. And so you can ask, what do you get? And the answer is pretty simple. Yeah. Oh, thank you very much. That's typo. So here's a yet another submersion called pi. We could take pi and evaluate it. We could take M and evaluate H on it. Now it's a diffeomorphism, so this we can apply to E like that. Then this groupoid that we've constructed is just going to be one of these groupoids associated to a submersion like that. And so what should we do? We'll take M2 comma M1 comma E1 comma E2. That's what something in this groupoid looks like. And we'll send it to, and now we need two pairs, and the correct pairs are something like this, M1, H of M1, oops, sorry, we should do the twos first. Yeah. And the question is, did I get there? Maybe I want inverses here. It's a little bit better. So, say again. Ah, sumimasen. Yes. So if I apply this pi to either of these, I get, oh no, so it's not quite right. If I apply, maybe I just want to put ME2 here. Yeah. My apologies. If I apply pi to M2 comma E2, I'll get H of M2 E2. And if I apply pi to M1 comma E1, I'll get H of M1 E1. And so the question is it true that H of M2 E2 is equal to H of M1 E1? Well, yeah, because that follows from this definition here, the way we defined alpha, and then the formula for the transformation groupoid here. As long as I got the inverses right. Ah, which I did, miraculous. What I just did in my head and in pantomime by pointing to things was argue that this map here is at least well-defined. It goes from this set into this set, and I leave it to you to check that this map is a bijection, is a diffeomorphism, and is an isomorphism of groupoids. That's what this guy needs. So once again, we're in a situation where we can perfectly well understand what is the C-star algebra of the groupoid. We're in this same situation we were in before, and the K-theory, to skip a couple of steps, the K-theory of the C-star algebra, in this particular case of our construction, comes equipped with a canonical isomorphism to the K-theory of C0 of, well, the quotient space, which was just E. Like that. The tangent groupoid is made up out of easy groupoids, which are like the one we've just discussed, together with slightly more complicated groupoids related to vector bundles, like we also discussed here. And in each case, the cross product object, the transformation groupoid, which you build from those parts, is quite easy to understand, both as a groupoid and from the perspective of K theory. Of course, we want to glue everything together, so we'll get to that in a moment. But this is one construction which, from Alain's point of view, it simplifies the K theory of the C star algebra of a vector bundle, because it turns the C-star algebra of a vector bundle into the C-star algebra of a space, a C0 space. Of course, the C-star algebra of a vector bundle is already some abelian thing. So by Gelfand and Neimark, it's already a space, which is not the same as this space here. But this is a construction which applies simultaneously to vector bundles M to N times M in a way which we'll see as in ways which we shall see are compatible with one another. Okay, so we had an easy construction and a few easy examples. And let me add to that a few theorems which are not so easy, but not so hard either. So maybe, I think, hopefully by now, this notation is internalized. I'm going to consider for the rest of the talk actions which are always by translations on E, which will always be a vector space. It could have been, I can't remember what I said now that I just erased this, but at the beginning it could have been any smooth manifold, although in these examples it was just a vector space. So E equals a real vector space. An alpha, an action by translations. So we can write alpha in the following way. Instead of being a map into diffeomorphisms, it can be just we'll think of it as just a map into E, again, a smooth map. So this map, the conditions on this map are that it should be a C infinity map, and alpha of gamma 1, gamma 2, gamma 1 should be alpha of gamma 2 plus alpha of gamma 1. and we'll write all actions additively from now on. One advantage of doing this is that you can multiply selection action by any scalar. Because if alpha is a homomorphism in the sense that I just described, alpha of gamma 1, gamma 2 is alpha of gamma 1 plus alpha of gamma 2, then so is S times alpha. So you can study all of these things here. I wasn't very explicit in my notation about the action. I didn't write down alpha in the notation for the transformation groupoid, and now I have to sort of fix that up somehow. So I'll write G cross E sub S for the corresponding groupoid. I still didn't mention alpha, but what you're supposed to think is that there's only one alpha we're caring about, but except for the fact that we want to rescale alpha by multiplying by a scalar. Of course, you could take all of these actions, the rescaled versions of the actions alpha, and glue them all together and get just one mother of all actions on E times R, like this. Using, let's call it alpha bar of gamma is equal to, now we're going into this thing here, is equal to S alpha gamma S, like that. This is again something that we already did in the world of the tangent groupoid. We studied this mother of all translations of, well, we were looking at one vector space acting on itself by translation. And what Kahn observes is that if you look at all of the C-star algebras you get, as you vary S, well, there's really only two C-star algebras that you get, because if S is non-zero, there's an obvious isomorphism, well, I'll get to that in a moment. All of these C-star algebras are basically the same for all non-zero S, but the one that you get when S is equal to zero is quite different, just like we saw with the tangent groupoid. And this thing here is a continuous field, like we were discussing. And you're not really supposed to mention the word continuous field without mentioning the continuous sections. So let's do it. Well, the obvious thing to do is study the smooth, compactly supported functions on big G times this mother of all actions, E times R. If you have a smooth, compactly supported function on G times E times R, then you can restrict it to G times ES for every S, and you'll get a smooth, compactly supported function there. And therefore, each element of this enormous set, actually it's a vector space, each element of this enormous vector space gives a family of elements, a section of this family of vector spaces. And when you do this, the axioms of a continuous field are satisfied, the main one being that the norm of the element in the C-star algebra you get by restricting to S is a continuous function in S. Why is this sort of thing true? So this If you're a topologist, you don't care about this. You just say to yourself, well, yeah, of course it's continuous. Everything's continuous and smooth, and so this is going to be continuous and smooth too. But it ain't quite that simple. But Kahn makes the following observation, that when you make this construction, what you're getting on the nose is a type of Sestrer algebra about which we know a great deal. Namely, you take E. And you take its Pontryagin dual group. So that's another group of all Lie group homomorphisms from E to the circle group. So that's another abelian group. It's another vector space of the same dimension as S. And let's keep the S in the notation here. And now I'll take a semi-direct product, a cross product in the language of Sestrer algebras with the Sestrer algebra of G. So what Kahn notes in the world of Sestrer algebras is that this geometric construction of, got my notation wrong, of the transformation groupoid followed by the Sestrer algebra construction can be thought of as two analytic constructions stacked on top of one another. One is the Sestrer algebra of G, and the other is this transformation, this cross product groupoid Sestrer algebra construction, excuse me. So the right-hand side here is the Sestrer algebra associated to an action. The action of E hat has automorphisms of the Sestrer algebra of G. Let's call it alpha hat. And what is this? Well, alpha hat should be evaluated on some character of E. So what should we call that? I don't know, sigma or something. So sigma is it's an element of the dual space of E. It's a homomorphism of Lie groups from E into the one-dimensional circle group U1. And now, if I have a smooth, compactly supported function on G, I want to explain how it's going to be transformed by the automorphism alpha hat of sigma. And here's the answer. What you get is another function on the Lie groupoid, and its value on gamma is just alpha of gamma. A bit more room. Sigma evaluated on S of alpha of gamma of F of gamma. There's some tautological thing. Alpha gamma is an element of the groupoid G. Alpha of gamma is an element of the vector space E. And when you multiply it by S, it's still an element of the vector space E. Sigma is a group homomorphism from that vector space to the group of complex numbers of modulus one. So this whole thing is just a complex number of modulus one, and you multiply it against the value F of gamma, and that defines a new function on the groupoid, which is just as smooth and just as compactly supported as before. And that's how you define this fellow. Of course, you have to show this formula, which I'm describing using the idea of smooth, compactly supported functions. You have to show that it does extend to these Sestrer algebra completions, which of course Kahn does. Well, he doesn't, but he did in his notebooks. And then you get this formula. What this does is it takes the problem of understanding this groupoid Sestrer algebra, and it puts it in another context, the context of cross product Sestrer algebras. Should have put those words here, crossed product Sestrer algebra, some twisted tensor product of the group algebra of E hat with Sestrer of G.
Yes, hat is homomorphism from E to U1.
Yes.
And alpha, that goes from E, where do you test
that? I don't. That's the way I've written it. I should remove the S there. I want to put an S in to indicate the dependence of S somewhere. Maybe I should put it down here. I should use, what am I calling it? Well, anyway, this action here, which depends on S. I guess I should do it like this, alpha. Okay, I don't want to put in another subscript. The formula depends on S, and the groupoid depends on S, and somewhere you should stick into your notation an S, but you can decide where to put it. It does depend on S. It doesn't depend on S in a
right hand side, like the cross processes their algebra. That doesn't depend.
It does depend on S, strictly speaking, but not up to isomorphism. So maybe I'll just make that point right now. It doesn't depend on S in an interesting way. How about that?
Okay.
Yeah, when S is equal to zero, this formula sort of degenerates, and the formula for this action doesn't depend on sigma anymore. In other words, the action is the trivial action. And what you get from this construction is not a twisted tensor product, it's just the tensor product of the group algebra of E hat with the C star algebra of G. So it's a special case. But the formula is still okay. Yeah, so you see that when S is zero versus when S is not zero, there's two different things happening. But if you take this continuous field, of all of these C star algebras, this thing, so just this is the rebuttal from Dan, this thing is isomorphic to a constant. C star algebras. Because all of these, in fact, all of the groupoids can be identified. So here we have an E2 gamma E1. And we can just send that to S of E2 gamma S of E1. So nothing fancy is, this is not an isomorphism, of course, if S is equal to zero, it's still a functor, but it's not an isomorphism. But when S is not zero, this is equivalence of categories, a diffeomorphism, it's everything all at once, it's just fine. And by the way, it also preserves the measures in a Haas system that we've assigned to the source fibers of all of these groupoids, because they all of these source fibers are the same. They don't depend on the action at all, they just depend on the groupoid. Okay, so that's what we're talking about. We have like we've seen more than once, we have a continuous field of C star algebras, and there's one exceptional fiber at zero, and then all of the others are the same. Okay. And in this situation, as we discussed last time, there's always a morphism from the K theory of the special fiber to the K theory of the, not exactly the generic fiber, the K theory of any other fiber, for example, the one at lambda equals one. So I'll just drop the S, S equals one, I'll just drop the S from the notation. And this thing is of some interest. This is an object which Kahn had dealt with previously, many, many years earlier. So the theorem is that if you take the K-theory groups of the C-star algebras of all of these represent all of these, oops, got the grammar wrong there. of all of these groupoids as S varies like this, all S now, not just S non-zero, this is constant in S. This is a constant, as we were discussing, say is constant. Thanks to continuous fields, the theory of continuous fields and a property of K-theory, these K-theory groups of the sister algebras in a continuous field, they always are the stalks of some sheaf, and that sheaf is the constant sheaf. Ah, constant sheaf, or isomorphic to a constant sheaf. And another way of saying the same thing is that the morphism above, which was previously studied by Kahn, and he called it a Tom homomorphism, this thing here, is actually an isomorphism. This, strictly speaking, we don't need these facts, but in if you want to consult a topologist and you want to ask him what a certain construction purely in the K-theory of spaces is, what is a good formula for it, then you'll probably need to supply that topologist with this additional piece of information. So this is Kahn's famous Tom isomorphism theorem in the world of C-star algebras. It applies in this sort of context that we're talking about. If you have a single C-star algebra A and an action of the group of real numbers on A by automorphisms, then you can imagine rescaling that action just by scalar multiplication, exactly the same as we just did. And you'll get a continuous field of C-star algebras now over the space of all real numbers S. And Kahn showed that that's always the K-theory groups are always constant, whatever the sister algebra is. Lots of interesting things to say there, but we need to move on a little bit. So we shall take this also for granted. I think this entire discussion of these ideas of Kahn deserves further study. There are lots of variations on these constructions that you might consider in these sophisticated modern times when we study filtered manifolds and the like, and index theorems for manifolds with filtered structures. So there are lots of questions you might ask about the technique of proving the index theorem, which is emerging slowly and stutteringly in this lecture, the technique that was worked out by Kahn. You could imagine doing some experiments by changing the starting point. Maybe it's not an ordinary manifold, maybe it's a contact manifold, maybe it's a blah, blah, blah. Nobody's done this. It seems to me worthwhile to really explore a bit more of the geometry behind these constructions that will, which is what we're about to get back to geometry probably instantaneously. So the comment I'm now making should be transposed mentally in your mind with the definition I'm now about to give. So I'll make a definition and then we'll continue. Okay, good. So these things we're going to take for granted, but they're really interesting and it's worth thinking about them. Reading again these old papers and thinking about what would happen if you turn this knob or turn this knob, maybe the some abelian group becomes the Heisenberg group, you know, what happens? I think those are really interesting questions. Good, which we won't ask. Now back to the tangent groupoid. And I want to remind ourselves of something after answering Paul's question. That's correct.
It just depends on the parameter that I mentioned. And
yep. Yeah, so maybe I'll make a remark. Thank you. It's worth making that remark. Here, in forming this object, the one I just wrote down with E0, it means we're using the action alpha multiplied by zero. So it's not an action at all. S, zero times alpha of anything, is just zero. So nothing interesting is happening here, really, that isn't already happening inside of G, or maybe inside of E0 separately. They're not speaking to each other. They're not interacting. And you can calculate this fellow without difficulty, and it's just the functions on E, not the dual of E or anything, just E, with values in the C star algebra. Oh, there's just one G like that. So this is easy. This is an isomorphism of the most basic sort, an isomorphism of C star algebras. And if you want to know what is the K-theory of this, then Bott periodicity answers that for you. That's one of the other things we discussed. Assuming that E is an even dimensional vector space, which it very soon will be, the K-theory of this thing is just the K-theory of C star of G. So that's rather easy to understand what you see over here. And this thing, well, you may say to yourself, it's more complicated to understand, but we're going to apply this construction or study this construction in a situation where, for a completely different reason, we can also easily understand what's going on here. And what I was going to do here is just maybe introduce some notation. The tangent groupoid of M can be broken up, it can be fibered, of course, by the source and range maps over M times R, but the source and range maps agree when you further project to R alone. And so the map that you get by applying the source and then just taking the T component of the source, that's a submersion to R. And all of the fibers are groupoids, Lie groupoids. And we'll want to study all of these things. I should change that S into a T. I'm having a crisis about notation. I haven't decided whether I really want T to be a number or a coordinate function. And at some point I'll screw up the notes by trying to change everything, confuse you. But of course here, I mean, T is a particular number, and if T is a particular number, and T sub M, Tm sub T means a particular fiber in the tangent groupoid. Usually it's just M times M, except when T is equal to zero, and then it's the tangent bundle of M. Okay. And now you can do the following thing. You can look at the C star algebras of all of these T sub M T's as they individually act on ES. And now T can be any real number, and so can S. And this too is a continuous field. Of C star algebras. Thank you. With continuous sections, just like before, generated by, well, we'll take smooth, compactly supported functions on the space you get, the groupoid you get, by gluing together all of the T sub M T, so that's just T of M. And now we'll let this thing act on this fancier space E times R, this mother of all actions that we were talking about before. This requires a proof. This is not trivial. And it comes about from Kant's perspective on the tangent group, on the construction, his perspective using cross-product algebras. And it's rather important because it has a key K-theoretic consequence. Oh, dang. Of course, I know perfectly well what it is because I've been preparing this lecture, but I forgot to tell you. Let's try to fix that up, maybe in this corner. Sorry about that. Thank you for rescuing me. Let's start with a smooth map from M into E. What I'm saying at the beginning applies to all possible smooth maps. But in a little while, I'll want to consider maps which are embeddings of smooth manifolds. And I'll want to consider E's which are even dimensioned. So neither of these extra conditions has a bearing on this theorem here, but it has a bearing on other things. So I'm going to start with an H, and then I'm going to define an alpha, having given myself an H. And what's alpha? Well, one possibility in the world of the tangent groupoid is that you have a morphism, a gamma in the tangent groupoid, which is just a tangent vector. That's what happens at t is equal to zero. And in this situation, I'll just define alpha of that vector to be h star of xm. What is h star? It's the derivative of h. The derivative of h sends a tangent vector on m at the point little m to a tangent vector on e at the point h of m. But e is a vector space, and everyone knows how to identify tangent vectors on a vector space with actual vectors, and that's what I'm doing. Okay, and then that's not the end of the story. I also have to tell you what alpha is on the rest. And here's a formula, which shouldn't be terribly surprising. I can fit it in. It's the difference quotient, h of m2 minus h of m1 over t. The thing on the right-hand side, t inverse times h of m2 minus h of m1, is the canonical example of an interesting function on the tangent groupoid defined when t is not zero, which extends smoothly to the situation when t is zero, okay? And what you get in that smooth extension is the associated derivative, which is this thing up here. So this is definitely a smooth function on the tangent groupoid, exactly by virtue of the way we define the tangent groupoid. Ah, and there's a choice involved in, if you're thinking of the tangent groupoid as a deformation to the normal cone, there's a choice involved about whether you identify normal vectors with tangent vectors via the projection onto the first factor in M times M or the second. And sad to say, here I am at variance with what's in Alain's book. He uses the other identification. And so the what's in his book differs from what's here by a minus sign here and there. Both are correct. He just uses this different identification. Okay. Yes, you could do that. I have such a remark later in the dying moments of the lecture. But yes, indeed, you could use the functoriality of T, or if you like, the functoriality of this deformation construction. All right. And now, thanks to the check or the theorem that's just mentioned here, this the diagram that I'm now about to write down is not just going to be a diagram, it's going to be a commuting diagram. And here's what we'll put at the top. Thank you. We have a continuous field of C-star algebras. This is something we did look at. When you take the tangent groupoid and you decompose it into all of these fiber groupoids, T, M, sub T, then you get a continuous field of C-star algebras. So there's a preliminary version of the theorem up here, which doesn't involve the E's. And that's a true theorem, and we did prove it. And thanks to that theorem and the fact that the groupoid is constant away from T equals zero, there is a morphism. Just like we were discussing, you take an element in this stalk, you extend it a little bit to get an element in some nearby stalk, C-star algebra of Tm sub epsilon, but as soon as you get to epsilon, Tm epsilon is equal to Tm1, so you're done. And so we have a map here. This is the analytical index map. This is what we were discussing in the previous two lectures. This is the thing that we want a formula for, because it takes, if you have an elliptic order zero pseudodifferential operator on M, it's a multiplier algebra of a certain C-star algebra, and it has a symbol which lies here, a K-theory class of the symbol which lies here. This thing here, this whole K-theory group, is just the integers. And what the map does, as we checked, is that it sends the K-theory of the symbol class of, excuse me, the symbol, the K-theoretic symbol class of an elliptic operator to the index of that operator. So this is what we want to calculate. Okay, now, let's plug in this space E0. So this is a situation where T of M is not actually acting on E. We're in this situation here, the C-star algebra is easy to understand. And if we assume, as we did assume somewhere, that I thought we did assume, yeah, E is even dimensional, then there's no difference in the K theory between these two fellows. This is the bond, periodicity isomorphism. And there's a similar one here, and it follows from the basic properties of the Bott periodicity map that this diagram commutes. And if we fix S equals zero and let T vary, then we still have a continuous field. And so there is still this map from the K theory of the special fiber to the K theory of the typical fiber. Like that. And now, instead of letting T vary, we can let S vary while keeping T fixed. And now there's a map from the K theory of this special fiber in the sense of S being special to the K theory of this typical fiber in the sense of the value of S here being typical. Same thing over here. Oh, I realized, oh no, this notation is fine. But I made a mistake, but I didn't. And here's the map that you get. Did make a mistake here. So the horizontal maps come from thinking of S as being fixed and T varying, and the vertical maps come from thinking of T as being fixed and S varying. And you might ask yourself, why is it that this diagram commutes? And the reason it commutes is that we have a continuous field. For any pair of numbers, S and T, there's a K-theory group, K-theory of C-star Tm, T, acting on E, S. There's a whole square's worth of K-theory groups. They form a gigantic sheaf. And just the existence of that gigantic sheaf tells you that this diagram is going to commute. That's an exercise in the notes. So that's the tricky part, and you get it for free from this continuous field perspective. And now we're getting very close to where we need to be. Yeah, good. And there's one more row on this diagram, but I need to pause for a moment and elaborate on the examples that we were discussing at the beginning of the lecture. Here, we're looking at the action of a vector bundle on an E. And this action comes from an embedding of the tangent bundle of M into the trivial bundle with fiber E. That's what H star does. The derivative of an embedding is an embedding of the tangent bundle. And so the K theory of this thing, in fact, this C star algebra we've determined exactly. This is a C star algebra, which is, well, in the language, which is the groupoid C star algebra for one of those groupoids coming from a submersion, as we discussed before. So the K theory of this thing is the K theory of the quotient vector bundle Q you get by dividing the trivial vector bundle with fiber E by the tangent bundle of M. In other words, it's the K theory of the normal bundle, of the C zero functions on the normal bundle. What appears down here is easy, easy, easy. In this bottom left corner, the K theory group is the K theory group of the C star algebra of C zero functions on the normal bundle associated to the embedding of M, the manifold, into E. The K theory over here is easy to compute as well, because when we restrict to T equals one, the groupoid is M times M. And we had a formula for figuring out what the cross product transformation groupoid is when you have M times M acting on E1 for any action at all on any manifold whatsoever. It's nothing to do with linearity or anything. And what we saw is that this is also one of those submersion groupoids. And the K theory is just the K theory of the space E, the continuous functions vanishing infinity on E. So this is the K theory of a space. This is the K theory of the space. And we just need to figure out a little bit more about this map, and we'll be done. And let's just do that, which is the final topic somewhere.
So are all the vertical arrows are isomorphisms?
It happens to be the case that all vertical arrows are isomorphisms, yeah. Well, as long as your Bott periodicity map goes in this direction, it's not relevant that the Bott periodicity map is an isomorphism. As long as this map goes in this direction, also not relevant, but indeed these are all isomorphisms. What I need to do in order to achieve some clarity towards the bottom of the picture is take the three or two really examples of calculations we did at the beginning of the lecture where we figured out what the transformation groupoid is, and we need to combine them into one calculation which answers the question, the geometric question, what is the groupoid that you get when you make this transformation groupoid construction when T is equal to one? Excuse me, S is equal to one. So when we're dealing with an actual embedding, so now I'm going to use the fact that H is an embedding and I'm multiplying by S equal to one, so it's still an embedding. And here is the answer. So here's a certain map, which you can conceptualize in a number of ways. I'm going to write down on the right one of these deformation spaces, deformations to the normal cones that we talked about before. And I'm going to embed M into E to make that deformation to the normal cone. But just a small funny detail, the sign comes, it's just the way it is. So Cohn figured out his sign, so he didn't have to put a minus one there. But that means there's a minus one somewhere else. But it's actually into the minus one version of E. That is to say, the embedding is not M goes to H of M, it's M goes to minus H of M. Okay, that's the way it works out. And what is this map? Well, over here, the points are easy to describe. Over here in deformation space land, it makes a difference whether T is zero or T is not zero. And here's what you do, let's put the generic one first. here's a combination of T's and E's and H of M's and so on, minus signs. What is this crazy thing, TE minus H of M, T? Well, I don't know, but it's certainly an element of the vector space E. It's a linear combination of things in E. Okay, so, and that's what the fibers of this deformation space are when T is not zero. On the other hand, when T is zero, then you can do the following thing. You can take E like that. And you can think of this E as a vector. You can think of it as not just a vector, but a tangent vector at the point H of M, actually the point minus H of M. And that's exactly what I'm going to do. So I want to think of E as a tangent vector at, it so happens, the point H of minus M, like that, okay? And what do the square brackets mean? I want to consider that tangent vector modulo tangent vectors which are tangent to the image of M. So in other words, the square brackets mean take the class of E in the normal bundle for this embedding, the minus H embedding. Okay, and then you just put zero. And this map here is a submersion. Let's give it a name, P. Apropos of what Eckhart was saying before, coming down to the wire here. One way of understanding what's going on here is to consider the normal space for the embedding of M into the product M times E, or M times E minus one. That's like embedding a manifold as the zero section of some vector bundle, in this case, the trivial vector bundle with fiber E. There's a small shift coming from the, you know, where the zero section is located. But whenever you embed a manifold in as the zero section in a vector bundle, the space you get is always very easy. What I wrote is correct, but to make it look like what was above, just reverse the factors like that. So one way of understanding this submersion is to understand this general fact that if you embed a manifold as a zero sections of a vector bundle, then the deformation space is just the vector bundle, in this case, M times E times R. And now this construction is functorial, so I can just project off the M. That's a submersion down to the space that we're talking about up there. So that's one way of thinking about this. And now the final calculation has to do with the space, the cross product space. This is when S is equal to one. The objects in this groupoid are M times R times E, and the same thing down here. So one of these is the source map, and the other is the range map. And these are our maps P down to the space I was just mentioning. And the theorem is that this diagram commutes, that in fact, this is pullback. The geometric fact. Okay. And it just follows from the definitions that everything hangs together. And for better or for worse, you need some minus signs to make it work. But okay, so I'll be good. So this groupoid is yet another example of one of these submersion groupoids. There must be a better name for them than that. One of these groupoids associated to a submersion map pi. is meaning via the particular map implied by the theorem. It's going to be this thing. So what I'm going to have to write down is this space crossed over by P, as I called it. And that allows us to calculate this map at the bottom over here. Thanks to the calculations that we did at the beginning of the lecture, this thing is just the K theory of the C0 functions on the normal bundle. I'll say Q or N. I use the notation Q when I gave the example earlier on. N is a little more traditional for normal bundle. Take your pick. Over here, we have the K theory of C0 of E. C0 of E, no groupoids. And the map at the bottom here is the map associated to the continuous field of C star algebras, which are the C0 functions on the fibers of this deformation to the normal space as T varies. That's another continuous field of C star algebras, a very easy continuous field of commutative C star algebras associated just the fibers of a submersion from this normal space down to the real line. And so this map here is within the realm of topology. And you can ask a topologist, what is this map? And he'll tell you right away that the map along the bottom you get in the following way. You take the space, the manifold Q or N, whatever you want to call it, you realize it by a tubular neighborhood embedding as an open subset of E. And then you take advantage of the fact that K theory is functorial in the right direction for inclusions of open subsets. That's the simplest case of so-called wrong-way functoriality. Usually K-theory is a contravariant functor of spaces, but in the particular case where you're including an open subset of a manifold into a manifold, or indeed an open subset of any space into the space, there's a wrong-way map from the K-theory of the open subset to the K-theory of the whole space. And that's what appears at the bottom. This thing, a topologist can tell you what it is. I just told you what it is too, so it's done, okay? These groups are all just the integers. These maps are all isomorphisms. We already know that this is just the integers. So modulo an issue of keeping track of generators, this is just integers, 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 and the maps are just identity, 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 okay? If you identify this K0 of C of E with the integers via Bott periodicity, the same Bott periodicity that you use up here, then the map, the composition is just the identity. Along the top, we have the index homomorphism. Down here, we have effectively just the Bott periodicity isomorphism from the integers to itself. And the only other thing you have to worry about is this guy. And this is the thing in the black box about which I'll just say a couple of words and then we'll stop. It comes from all of this Kantong isomorphism stuff. If you want to calculate what this map is, you can do so divorced of everything else in this diagram. You can just focus on what happens here. And what you can observe is that this thing exists for any smooth vector bundle. V and embedding into a trivial bundle. And what you have on one side is the C star algebra of the groupoid associated to a vector bundle. And on the other side, you have the C star algebra of functions on this quotient vector bundle that we were talking about before. So the map, which is given by a question mark, is generalizable. So that's a clue that it cannot be that hard. It belongs to the world of bundle theory. It's much easier than many other worlds, like real life, much easier than real life to study vector bundles. Now this thing, if you're going to ask a topologist what this is, the first thing you have to do is get rid of the C star algebra rubbish. I'm not going to like that. So let's just do it like this. V is a real vector bundle, and V star means the dual vector bundle whose fibers are the vector space duals of the fibers of V. And what do we have over here? Well, we have Q, and maybe the right way of thinking about Q is like this. We'll take E times V times V star, and dividing by V plus V star. So V is a vector bundle, and So really what we're studying is E mod V, but it's a little better to, which is Q. It's a little better to think of this as E plus V star mod V plus V star. It's the same thing. You killed the V star you put in the first place. And now the question is, what is this map? And the answer is something that the topologists can answer for you. For any vector bundle V, or V star, you can do the following thing. First of all, according to Bott, you can just stick in E. I guess we're using C zeros.
Right, so what you've written, E plus V star mod E plus V star, that is just Q on a nose, right?
Canonically isomorphic to Q, or okay, so it is Q, something like that, yeah.
Okay, so the squiggle is like almost an equals.
Yep. Okay.
Basically, trivial.
E is, yeah, maybe I should put underline or something. I mean, the vector bundle, the constant bundle with fiber E.
Yeah, but the question is just there's no tomfoolery with that map, which is great.
Yeah, there's no tomfoolery with this map. This is about periodicity isomorphism. And what is this one here? Well, what we're doing is we're taking the vector bundle E. Inside of E sits V. So inside of E plus V star sits V plus V star. And in fact, I could write the whole bundle E plus V star as Q plus V star. And V plus V star is not just any vector bundle, it's a bundle of symplectic vector spaces. And the Tom isomorphism applies if you have any vector bundle and you want to cancel out a vector subbundle, which is a symplectic bundle or a complex vector bundle or just about any reasonable type of vector bundle without changing the K-theory, you can do so because there is a famous Tom isomorphism which allows you to do it. And so what you need to do is take this information and give it to the topologist to so he can tell you what this Tom isomorphism is. The theory of the Tom isomorphism in K-theory is a little complicated in regular cohomology. You can just talk about the Tom isomorphism. That's it. There's one and only one Tom isomorphism. That's not the case in K-theory. So when I say Tom, I that's not enough. There are many different people called Tom, and you have to say, which Tom is it? But that's the job of the topologist, to write down this map and give a reasonably useful formula for this map so that we and then prove that this diagram here commutes. So the answer to the final question, to the final index problem, is that the index is given by a map, which is basically a Tom isomorphism, followed by an inclusion into a wrong way map into an ambient Euclidean space E, followed by, well, Bott periodicity. And that's what Atir and Singer discovered and what Alain figured out using this technology. So next time we'll try to make this a bit more concrete at the expense of two things. First of all, generality. And secondly, at the expense, of throwing away groupoids. We'll speak only of geometric spaces next time to do essentially the same thing, but in a more concrete way. Good. Questions?
So like this is significantly higher time.
No, I would not. No, I mean, Atir and Singer, of course, were pioneers, and they are not they, but their consultants, people like Nirenberg and Cohen, were inventing the relevant pseudo-differential operator theory on the fly, and then Atir and Singer had to synthesize all of that with algebraic topology K-theory, which was also basically invented on the fly. I mean, just a decade earlier by Atir and Herzberg. So they had to build everything from scratch. If you accept that you live in a non-commutative geometric world and you accept certain facts about C-star algebra theory as now, you know, foundational and basic, then this argument becomes very, very conceptual. And I would say that this becomes better. After you've proved the theorem of Atir and Singer, as Atir and Singer proved it in Atir Singer 1, there's still the problem of actually calculating what the heck is it, and what's a formula for this map for a particular operator in terms of characteristic classes. That second problem is about equivalent, although it does it's about numbers, not K-theory groups. It's essentially this argument here. So let me put this in another way. There is Atir Singer 1 and Atir Singer 3, and between them they prove the index theorem. Atir Singer 2 is about families. And this part, understanding what's going on here, is basically Atir Singer 3. It's the same. But as for Atir Singer 1, it's which was this tour de force of analysis and K-theory and everything, it's basically made trivial. The one thing that you need from the realm of analysis is this guy here. This is a continuous field. Yeah, of course it depends on what you know and what you're disposed to feel that you understand. But I would say that from beginning to end, this is more efficient because throughout this entire discussion of the index theorem, you don't actually need to mention the word pseudo-differential operator even once. They're just gone. This thing, which was the C-star algebra of T of M, or let's just say T of M itself, is an object on which pseudo-differential operators just naturally live, a scaling family, some slightly jazzed up version of what is a pseudo-differential operator. It's just a multiplier algebra of a C-star algebra. That's easy conceptually, I think, to explain what it is. And then that's it. For any multiplier, it doesn't have to be a pseudo differential operator. Each time you have a multiplier algebra, multiplier of the Sestier algebra you get by gluing together all of these fibers between zero and one. Each time you have a multiplier, however you got it, you get a formula for the index. So I think this is a better argument because it compartmentalizes the analysis and the geometry better. It's true that there are ingredients like this continuous field that may seem odd, you know, if you belong to the pseudo-differential operator camp or the geometry camp, you may not be predisposed to like this, but it's not actually a difficult thing. Yeah.
Yes. You know, one question, maybe that we've only proved, as you say, the index theorem for multipliers, so zero order.
Ah, yeah. Yeah, what it
seems to be the most one.
That's true. So next time we'll talk about the Dirac operator. So that will partially address your concern. If you want to prove the index theorem for pseudo-differential elliptic pseudo-differential operators of order three, then you need to somehow cope with the fact that operators of order three are not bounded. And of course, there are techniques for doing that. Exactly, some kind of bounded transform argument or multiply by the Laplacian to the minus 3/2th power or something like that. Yeah, that's a good point. There's still that to be done.
Will Everett's in like this argument, if you think it's bounded, you get it, you get it's bounded. But I don't understand why it doesn't bind the index.
Why is the index?
Then get something bounded, but.
Yeah, so as you say, there's a method of taking an elliptic order three operator and converting it into an elliptic order zero operator. And now you want to know, why does the index not change? Well, if you look in the homework exercises to maybe the last lecture, what you'll see is that the index of an order zero elliptic pseudo-differential operator is much more than the dimension of the kernel of the operator as it acts on L2 minus the dimension of the co-kernel. It's the dimension of the kernel as the operator acts on C infinity sections minus the dimension of the co-kernel. So it's very simple to remove the extraneous Hilbert space theory that comes about when we're discussing Sestier algebras here. We made operators into Hilbert space operators so that we could use the language of Sestier algebras. Why did we do that? Well, we wanted to use K-theory, and that's already existing for Sestier algebras. And so we had to take a pseudo-differential operator and make it into something in the world of bounded Hilbert space operators. That's not necessarily good news, but the good news is that when you make that transformation, the index doesn't change. And it's an elementary argument. I mean, the argument which is not precisely the answer to your question is written in the homework exercises. But I think you could then make a new exercise for yourself and solve this problem of the bounded transform. Good. Got to look. No questions there. Looks like we are done.